Thank you much for this introduction. So you can be like sure I will not talk much about these Python problems at the moment, because this is like not regarding this coupling with Dumux that I want to talk about. And but this Dumux coupling, what we have here today, is also joint work with Kian Weishaupt and Bernd Flemisch. These are some of the main developers of Dumux at the moment. So yeah, this is like part of the slide you've seen before. This collaborative research center is concerned with interface-driven multi-field processes and porous media flow, transport, and deformation. So in this sense, it's like a lot of fields of potential applications of Precise, because it's like about interfaces and their multi-field processes. And like I basically at the moment work on mainly on two sub-problems. This one is also partially what you saw about before, it's like this porous medium coupling or flow in porous medium and flow in the free flow domain, where you have then say your topic of free flow, where you have some flow going over the porous medium that also then influences the flow in the porous medium. Like examples, for example, the flow of water over a riverbed, where you have some maybe some exchange of contaminants and you want to predict that. Or say you spill something on your clothes and they come with a hairdryer to dry that, then you also have some kind of porous medium that's your clothes and this flow goes over that. But this is then also, say, already a bit more complicated because you get evaporation and multi-phase problems in there. There's a potential like use case here, this simple case of having a water flowing over this porous medium, and you see you have a flow field also in the bottom part, but say from the color coding you see also the velocities in the porous medium are much, much smaller. Yeah, another thing I'm looking into that's not completely was not really in the framework of Dumux, but it's also like very nice, and it's like where these Python problems usually pop up, is work on fractured porous media. This is joint work with Patrick Schmidt and Holger Steb in Stuttgart, and they investigate the opening of fractures. Like an example application, also simulation you see here, it's about fracking, what you kind of need or want to do for geothermal applications, or if you want to get rich and get oil. The idea is roughly that you see some kind of fracture in the rock or whatsoever, and you want to open that, so you drill a hole just right through that, close this hole in the bottom, and then start injecting some fluid that forces this fracture to open. And this here is also like a simulation you see, where you have like this kind of blue plate, is like a lower dimensional representation of the fluid flow in this fracture. And then here, this green domain you see is like the deforming rock, and you see that this deformation in this is colored red. So the nice thing about these applications is depending on how you model them, or at least say the way we want to model them today, they have like sharp interfaces. Sharp interfaces are nice because then we can use this coupling with Precise rather naturally. And what you see here are also both simulations that we have been running with Precise involved here. So the rough outline of my talk is like that. I hope, my ambition was to put something in for everyone, so I hope everyone finds something interesting in here. I will start with like, the general problem setup that I want to talk about, or that what I solve at the moment with Dumux. That gives you like, a very slight introduction into porous media flow. Then it's a bit, afterwards I will talk a bit more about Dumux. I guess most of the people haven't used it yet, at least on the list of participants. I haven't seen anybody than me using Dumux at the moment, but a lot of people into porous media, so maybe there's also a solver that you are interested in. Then I will talk a bit about how you use Dumux and how this kind of also influenced my workflow in writing an adapter. And I will also talk a bit about the adapter, what is the current state. I will show you some code if you like that. I will show you some equations beforehand if you like equations. I will have a lot of pictures, or I try to make a lot of pictures so it's not too boring for you. Then I will show you, say, some numerical results with what we have obtained so far with this adapter. And then, end this talk with conclusion and outlook. So let's see what problem setup we want to look into. There's like this image again. So today I only want to talk in this Dumux setting about free flow coupling and porous media flow coupling. I assume this has like a sharp interface, and first I have to model the flow in each of the subdomains. For the free flow domain, say I keep it rather simple. We go for incompressible flow, rather moderate speeds. So we go with Stokes equations and with mass conservation equations that we have to solve here. For the porous medium domain, it's also incompressible. What we solve is also kind of mass, or what we want to have there is mass conservation. And then Darcy's law. I'm not sure how many people are familiar with porous media here. So it's like I went to my kitchen and took a picture of a sponge that I usually use for cleaning, and this is like a common example of porous media. If you like look into onto a sponge, it's like a solid with like a lot of holes, or it's like a hollow space with a lot of obstacles. Depends on what perspective you have, and you see it's like when we use it for cleaning, it has very special properties. Like water that flows in also flows out at some point, or most of it, but very much slower. These processes that are happening there as kind of a flow process, but if you just want to like watch the or see the large scale problem, it doesn't really necessary to solve the normal kind of flow problems that you would have to. You still can do that. Like if you go like really into a very small scale of like micrometers, you can say, I can model this sponge now as a free flow domain with a lot of obstacles. For simplicity, I say, okay, it's a regular, say, cylinder-shaped obstacles that I have there that kind of force my flow to be rather slow. But in the end, if you are only interested into the large-scale behavior in the scale of centimeters, meters, or something larger, you don't want to resolve your flow on that scale. Your mesh looks horrible. You have so many degrees of freedom, so people don't do that. What they then do is like upscaling. So you kind of derive Darcy's law from this kind of assumption that gives you then like a simplified kind of equation that you have a pressure-driven flow, and in there you have like the viscosity and this permeability tensor that kind of models this effect of obstacles in your flow domain. Then kind of, since maybe most of you haven't seen that, this is the kind of what you solve. You can also plug in or like take the divergence of the Darcy equation and then instead solve like a second order elliptic equation. So for the people that are a bit more into this already, for the talk here, I will make my life not complicated, easy. So the tensor here, I say, is an isotropic homogeneous material. This means like the off-diagonal is zero and the terms on the diagonal are also constant. It's not really like, shouldn't be a restriction for what I do, but for the moment, keep it simple. So now we need some kind of conditions for this coupling. What do I want to do there? What we also use at the moment is standard coupling conditions called Beevers-Joseph-Zeffmann coupling conditions. And I think also most of the part is not really surprising, I guess, for the most people, especially if you do maybe something like fluid interaction. So we have conservation of mass, balance of normal forces. And what is like then a bit special here is like this slip velocity condition that you have. So if your fluid flows over this porous medium, since there's also some fluid, it's not like a no-slip wall or so, but you have some kind of slip velocity here. And this is like one approach that has been derived. We have this kind of alpha here that is like a model parameter that's kind of good and nice on one side, but also sometimes annoying because it's a parameter that you can choose to fit your problem. So on one side, if this approach doesn't really work well at the moment for your current test case, you can just fiddle around with that until it works. But on the other hand, if you want to run your simulation, you most likely don't know your alpha beforehand, so you might need some testing here and there. What you say you have to take from that, or should take from that, what's important for the coupling in the end with precise is like you couple via these conditions, and what you then have to exchange is pressure in one direction and the normal velocity in the other direction. So let's come to how we actually solve these things with DuMux and precise. So first, what is DuMux? DuMux is a dune for multi-phase component scale physics, flow and transport and porous media. It's like an open source C++ framework that is mainly developed in Stuttgart. It has been initiated there at the Institute for Modeling of Hydraulic Environmental Systems. Itself is based on Dune, which is like the distributed and unified numerics environment. It's like a C++ library to quickly, easily solve partial differential equations. It's also, both are very powerful in the sense like toolboxes. It's like not a solver you compile once and then just throw your input files in there. Like most people maybe say use OpenFOAM, but it's more like you have a lot of pre-made classes and solvers where you can quickly collect the things you need for the to solve this one problem that you want to solve at the moment. Or if you want, you can also solve several problems and just include more files. It's like rather abstract. It uses extensive amount of C++ templates, Voodoo. So this is makes it very powerful, but maybe sometimes also a bit intimidating in the beginning, because you have to read a bit through the documentation that you know what you do, and most likely then it doesn't work until your compiler message or error message is like 20,000 lines long and you don't know what was the actual initial error. But yeah, don't be too worried. It's there. Like a bigger community, they're very helpful, and also with the documentation, you can get that done. Then, since it's like this flexible framework, it can be applied to all kinds of problems in the porous media world. Like common examples that I've taken from the homepage, like on the left side, what you see is like the root system of a plant, and this plant is extracting fluid or water from the soil. On the right-hand side, what you see is like a CO2 storage simulation where you simulated, I think, like the behavior of injecting CO2 in like an underground reservoir over like the time period of 50 years. So it's like can do 3D, 2D, whatever, what kind of physics that you want. These figures don't look so fancy that I've taken from the Dumux tutorial. It also can do fractured porous media, where you have like your porous medium here and take these fractures that kind of disturb this porous medium, and then if you have a flow simulation and like you look, for example, into the pressure, you see clearly an influence of these fractures that are kind of sharp interfaces intersecting the porous medium. What they also have, what is also a bit more interesting now for us, they have some free flow porous medium coupling already integrated. This picture actually looks a bit cooler than what, potentially cooler what I've shown you before, because they actually don't use just a straight interface, but like a sine curve to get a bit of more things going on there. But yeah, this approach they have at the moment is not partitioned, but monolithic. So there's more features. You can also use adaptive meshes, pro network models, and this monolithic coupling manager, coupling scheme they have in there is more interesting to like what I want to do or what I do, because it's something I can compare with, or like, also something I have to compete with, depends on how you see it. But they also struggle with the common problems that they are monolithic problems. Multiphysics problems are hard to solve. Your system of equations is ill-conditioned, since you have the kind of different physics or different speeds in different parts of the domain. And like also like another problem, what is like, not only in this group, but like it's also like for them is like they are interested in these free flow porous media coupling problems. But initially, all these people that are mainly developing the code are more porous media people. This Dumux has been mainly then also been coded for these porous media problems, and this flow solver that they have in there now for the monolithic coupling is rather new, because they wanted to have these coupled problems. But this also means this flow solver, compared to the porous media solver, is not that mature, not so well optimized. A lot of features or things you can do easily with the porous media solvers are not yet in the in the free flow part. So in this sense, this would be one motivation to go for this partition coupling with precise, so you could then easily use like your favorite flow solver on the flow domain. Now, setting up the simulation in Dumux, if in case you want to use it, you basically, for normal problems, say if it's not coupled yet, so you need kind of two files. You have like a header file with a template class that defines your problem, where you then kind of collect the data structures from Dumux that you want to use. This is now like for this Darcy flow problem. And it's basically just defines kind of that you use a cell center two-point flux approximation as space discretization. It's like it derives from this porous medium flow problem, so it kind of already knows what equation to solve with that. And then most likely for most of the problems, and if you want to define it, what you have to do is just like give it initial conditions, Dirichlet and Neumann conditions, and that you can implement there. So it might look a bit intimidating, but in the end, it's not too much that you have to do. This is then also already interesting to see like for the adapter that I want to write, because I apply Dirichlet-Neumann conditions here. This is also kind of I apply my coupling conditions here, that the data I will have to exchange with precise, I also have to read somehow in my class here. Then the other thing you need is a main file that actually drives your simulation. You include all the things that you needed. What you then do is like it looks nice. It's like this template Voodoo that is going on, but basically you have your Darcy problem here that you define. You create this object and then you use it, then you solve it, and you're happy. And for coupling, this means the simulation is driven there. This is kind of so this coupling has to be driven there. There we have to decide or I have to do the checkpointing and see if this coupling iteration has converged or hasn't. So yeah, the main observations, as I said, the main routine drives the simulation, so it should also, at least for now, drive the coupling. The last subproblem applies these coupling conditions, wants the data also from the coupling interface. And if you look a bit more into the code, what you see would at least would be helpful if I can check there if a point is on the interface or not. So I know if I actually have to ask presize for data or if I just ask my normal routine for boundary data. What I haven't shown you, but is kind of interesting when I was starting with that, they also already have some level of abstraction for this coupling in the monolithic sense. So they have a function coupling manager that the people are, say, used to to use for these couplings. So in some sense, it's like for my things, I don't necessarily need to care because I understand presize quite well now, but I also want to that others can profit from my work. So I also want to integrate this adapter in a way that it's usable for others, especially people that are used to follow the normal Dumux approach. So the idea is then that the adapter's interface should be somewhat close to this coupling manager's interface. If it's completely the same or not, I will talk a slightly bit later about that. And what I'm starting with, or what I'm also doing at the moment, actually, I will couple just Dumux and Dumux. I will just solve the free flow part with Dumux, and then the sparse media part with Dumux. This is not like, say, the long or midterm goal, but it's quite nice for the beginning because it allows me also to compare my solution that I compute with presize against this monolithic solution to get then a rough idea if I do the correct thing and also maybe to verify my implementation and my approach. Then, what my kind of goals would be that it embeds naturally in this Dumux framework that this interface does not look too crazy or too different from what the normal coupling interface looks like. It should be somewhat versatile that I not just can do this free flow, process media flow coupling, but maybe also heat transfer, multi-component, multi-phase, whatever. In some sense, what I learned then, when I started, in this sense, my interface, at least at the beginning, shouldn't be too problem specific. I started with some conjugate heat transfer problem, then all my functions were like read temperature, write temperature, and then I wanted to go free flow porous media coupling, and then I was like, yeah, I can reuse this function, but they don't really represent anymore what I do there. And then one thing at least that is important for the Dumux people, that this precise dependence should be optional. They don't want to force anybody to use precise, but they are open for people to do that. Then short overview that this precise adapter at the moment for me, I've implemented as a singleton program technique, at least say for me it was easy. I can now just include my header everywhere where I need it and create an query the instance so I can easily access it from my main file and my header file. This coupling manager is doing that with shared pointers. It's probably a maybe smarter way to do this in the long term. What I also put in there, at least what I found first practical for the testing, but also now partially used in the adapter is like a mapping between these vertex indices I have in Dumux, in Precise, and my indices for the unknowns in Dumux, because I can realize like an interface that looks somewhat similar to what you have in Dumux normally. This is like for the monolithic coupling manager. Lots of function calls going on, but what you basically see, you can ask the coupling manager, is this entity at the moment a coupled entity or not? And if so, take information from the coupling manager. And for this new class, for this preset that I have, it at least feels very similar. So people that are used to Dumux shouldn't be too surprised by that or too shocked by that. The current status of the adapter is like you can kind of use it, at least with approach, you can access the relevant functions from all the Dumux functions that need to access it. I can couple scalar data that I've done with no problem. It supports explicit, implicit coupling schemes. What I also say the positive is the code lives in the Dumux repository. My main hope is that we can integrate it into Dumux sometime, and then the code is already, say, kind of close to the main code. Is a good sign that maybe the hurdle to actually merge it sometime later into the main Dumux code is not too big. Say coupling or exchanging vectorial data is implemented, but I haven't in testing at the moment. work in progress is a bit like this interface of convenience functions, like querying which what data is on the interface, what not. But also to raise a bit the question, how should the interface look like? It cannot really completely look like the coupling manager for the monolithic coupling, because the coupling and the nature of the coupling is a bit different, and is in some sense should also be visible to the user that they don't mess up anything there. Then this integration to Dumux should be a bit tighter, so it's kind of this merging into the main Dumux branch. And pre-size is an optional dependency, but how we realize in the end, we have to see. So I have still a little bit of time to quickly talk a bit about the first numerical results. So what we do solve is kind of this domain you've seen in the beginning. It's two square domains with same mesh size. We have this free flow on the top that is forced by a pressure gradient. On the porous medium is completely closed, so it only can exchange data or via this coupling interface. I will go for an extremely strict conversion criterion for a precise, so because I kind of want to compare that to this monolithic scheme. Don't be like, too scared about that. And what we solve here for the testing at the moment is a steady state problem. Data exchange is like that, that the free flow solver gives pressure to the porous medium solver, and the porous medium solver then gives a normal velocity on the interface back to the free flow solver. And then if you let it run and plot our results, we are extremely pleased because it looks identical. So like in the eyeball norm, I'm very happy. If you rescale that for the velocities in the porous medium, it also still looks very nice. Also see that in here, this actually the order of magnitude of velocity is much smaller than it was for the free flow. If you say, okay, eyeball norm is not enough, and you actually compute the errors, you still see it's really good, especially for the pressures, the errors are very small. Also the velocity in the porous media domain is small. The velocity errors in the free flow domain are a bit bigger, and we haven't figured out yet completely why, but we see that this coupling conditions in the monolithic solver and in the partition solver are somehow handled a bit differently. This is something we have to figure out, but we are positive that this is possible. The positive thing, at least what we see or saw, is like I coupled this like with all implicit coupling schemes that I found, and I almost seem to converge against the same solution, so I don't see any difference in errors between these approaches. If you look into this coupling behavior and coupling iterations, what you see is that basically all of them work. If you start with this porous media domain first in the serial coupling, you get conversions to smaller residuals, but it's not too bad for the other theory case where you start with a free flow domain first. For the parallel implicit case, it's a bit more zigzagging, but also nicely converges underneath this bound we wanted to reach. What you also see, what is the thing to think about, that for some of the couplings, the first few iterations, there's actually not much happening. That is mainly because we initialize this precise or the interface data rather really stupid, just with zero. That it might take one coupling iteration before one solver actually sees something from the other solver. Okay, that then brings me also to the end of my talk. You see, we have some adapter for Dumux that is more or less ready to use. What I haven't shown you on my to-do list, this is like documentation. This is always something you can improve on, I guess. The partition coupling for us works nicely so far. We also get good agreement with the monolithic coupling, so we're quite happy with that, but we have to figure out what is going on in this Stokes domain or this free flow part. We want to integrate it nicer into the Dumux. My hope, maybe we can merge something or some part of this adapter already into the next Dumux release. Also, like, we want to go for much more challenging problems. This was rather like a toy problem, but like time-dependent problems, then also the preset coupling could profit from this time history of data on the interface. Bigger problems for parallel computations, multi-phase flow, other things that you, for like this evaporation of liquid, for example, out of a porous medium. And one interesting point there would be like that replace the free flow solver by something else, like open foam, that is much more tailored to this free flow domain problems or free flow problems. That's then the end of my talk, and thank you very much for your attention. Yes, I think also Brinkmann's model should be in there. And Depending on what you want to do, they have these poor network models. So there's more in there than I just showed you. I would say I don't know what else more is in there that we have to check out on dumux.org. We are not that deep into this porous medium topic yet. I would say at least for me, yes. I mean, at least I started from scratch. For me, it was Presize was new in Porous Media too, and like maybe a bit more of the coding guy. So for me, it was like nice to just go first and check the API, and also then check the API or the interface of Dumux to see what is going on there. Because I was like, this what I showed you, this coupling is kind of based on one of the tutorial test cases. So it's also something like how I got into Dumux. But at least for me, it was like the natural workflow in my case now. Sorry, what do you mean? This is a partial slip condition or not. I mean, you have some slip for the free flow domain on that part. I mean, the speed reversal of Sethman in the sense of, again, a special case, it says, okay, the flow speed in the porous medium is so small that you can just neglect that. It makes your life a bit easier, might be a bit less accurate, but yeah, you could also do something else there. Like in general, like for me, say, it's from the coupling perspective, I don't see much of a problem. If it's physically meaningful is a different question in the end. Also with this Beavers Joseph Sethman works very well, so a lot of people use it. The more complex one, Beavers Joseph, works also well. A lot of people use that, but also a lot of people use it in settings where it's actually not meant to be used, and it still works well. So people don't, well, say applied people don't care that much about that. Mathematicians still do. No. I think if you want to try that, get in touch with me. We have a repository. I'm honestly not completely sure if it's publicly visible or not, because it's not always clear with this, but in their GitLab that they use, but there's no problem to get the code. But don't be too shocked to see some undocumented code parts and things like that. But the aim that it's publicly available, merged into Dumux is also open source and should be documented. I guess then the main documentation would end up somewhere in their documentation, and we could put like hopefully some reference from the Presize to Dumux or something like that. It's linear. Yes. I'm not completely sure what exactly you mean. So what we do, we transport the pressure from free flow to porous medium. It's basically a linear pressure gradient that you have that you then also see main more or less in the porous medium domain. In some sense, everything is like rather linear here because also these velocities are very slow. This was not Stokes. I also ran this test case not once for testing with Navier-Stokes. So it's non-linear, but what you see is like you don't see any difference because the flow velocities are so small that this convective part is kind of doesn't contribute to anything. But checking that with higher velocities is also something to look into for the future. Sorry? I don't specify it explicitly with like a dimensional simulation, but if you derive the Reynolds number there, I think it was about 10. So it's a creeping flow. Yes. I don't think, again, for the coupling, I don't see too much of a problem at the moment, but we haven't tried that yet. But from what I know, like DuMux itself should handle that, so it shouldn't be a problem for me. Especially if it's this coupling, I mean, I exchange velocity and pressure. So from a technical perspective, yes, if it's the coupling in the end is stable, I don't know yet. But with this accelerator schemes, I'm sure it will work out.